Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In this video, we will discuss about the three-phase full converter. This is basically a rectifier circuit. You are going to provide AC supply and you are going to get the DC output. In this particular case, we are going to consider highly inductive load. That means L by R is quite high. In the previous video, we have discussed about the semi-controlled converter. In semi-controlled converter, the high side switches are thyristor and the low side switches are diode. But in the full converter, as you can see over here, your high side switches are the thyristors and the low side switches are also the thyristors. And at any instant of time, to complete the path of the current, you will have to turn on two thyristors. So you will be applying the pulses to a pair of thyristor to complete the conduction loop. For example, if I say the voltage between A and B is to be applied to the load, then you will have to turn on the thyristor 1, where it is connected with the phase A, and in the reverse path you will have to turn on the thyristor 6. So you will have to apply the gate pulses to T1 and the T6 in order to complete the loop between the phase A and phase B, so that the current can flow in your load. So what will be the loop for the current? Current will be starting from here through this thyristor, through the load, and then through this thyristor back to your phase B. So this is the path of the current, right? So the two thyristors are to be turned on at any instant of time to complete the path, right? Okay, now let's look at the waveforms. So the three phase waveforms are shown over here, the phase voltages and the line voltages. In the last video, we have discussed about the reference point. These points are considered as the reference points, but over here there will be six reference points because we are going to turn on six switches. In the semi-controlled converter, we have only three switches, controllable switches, and we generate three pulses and we select three reference points. But over here we are going to select six reference points because you can see there are six switches in this particular fully controlled bridge. So over here this point will be considered as the reference point. Why? Because let's consider that it's a diode bridge. So if it is the diode bridge, then the output voltage waveform will be like this. We have discussed it in the previous videos. So the output voltage will be the envelope of these line voltage waveforms. So considering this as the reference point, because this phase VAB should be contributing from this point till this point, so the thyristor which are connecting now these two phases, phase A and phase B, T1 in the high side and for the phase B T6 in the low side. So over here we will have to turn on these thyristors if you want to get this waveform at the output. So you will have to apply the two gate pulses to the thyristor T1 and to the thyristor T6 at this instant of time if you want this VAB at the output. And if you want this voltage waveform at the output, so what you will have to do, T1 is already on, phase A is on, because in this the conduction is from A to C. So you will have to apply the gate pulse to the thyristor of phase C in the reverse direction, so this one T2. So you will be giving a pulse to the thyristor T2 at this point if you want this voltage waveform at the output. And then there will be a commutation in the low side switches from T6 to T2 at this point, right over here, when you are going to apply the pulse, and the path will be now from phase A to phase C. And then you will have to apply the gate pulse over here to the thyristor of phase B. Phase C thyristor is already on, that you can see from here. Phase C is over here, repeated. So you are just going to turn on the thyristor of phase B, and thyristor of phase B, the current has to flow from B to C. So B phase is connected with the thyristor 3. So you are going to apply the pulse to the thyristor 3 over here, and so on. Over here you will be applying the pulse to thyristor 4, and then to thyristor 5, and then to thyristor 6. So if you number them in such a way that 1, 3 and 5 are the high side switches and 4, 6 and 2 are the low side switches, then in this case you will see that these pulses will appear in order by the thyristor number T1, T2, T3, T4, T5 and T6. So it's easier to now remember the order if you number your switches in this way, 1, 3, 5, 4, 6, and 2, right? So now if I say that I want to change the firing angle, I want to change the output voltage, I will have to change the position of this pulses. Let's suppose that 30 degree firing angle, so you will delay the pulse of your first thyristor by 30 degrees, so your firing angle is 30 degree over here. Similarly, from this reference point, you are going to apply the pulse at 30 degree, and then from this reference point, you are going to apply the pulse at 30 degree. So all the pulses will be delayed by 30 degree. So one thing that I want to explain over here, that these crossings are going to act as the reference point. Reference point for your thyristor 1, reference point for your thyristor 2, reference point for your thyristor 3, reference point for your thyristor 4, and so on, right? So you have 6 reference points, so you will be generating the pulses with respect to these crossing. Or you can also talk in terms of the absolute angle starting from this point, but in order to understand easily, I prefer to look at these reference points. 3 reference points are for the high side switches. This reference point 1, 3, and 5, this is for the high side switch, and 2, 4, and 6, these reference points are for the low side switches, right? So now let's look at the operation of this converter circuit for different firing angles. And let's suppose that we are going to fire our thyristors at the 0 degree, 0 degree from the reference point. So these are the reference points for the thyristors, and if we fire the thyristors at the reference point, so this will be the output voltage waveform for the firing angle of 0 degree. Means your thyristor 1 is fired over here, thyristor 2 is fired over here, assuming that thyristor 6 is on from the last cycle. If it is not, if it is the very first cycle, then you will have to turn on the T6 along with the T1, and then T2 over here, then T3, and then T4 over here, and then T5, right? And then T6. T6 is turned on by applying this gate pulse. So here you can see, from here till this point, your thyristor T1 and T6 will be conducting, and from this point till this point, your thyristor 1 and thyristor 2, that will be conducting. From this interval of time, T2 and T3 will be conducting. For this interval, T3 and T4 are conducting, and T4 and T5 are conducting, and then T5 and T6 are conducting. This interval is extended in at this point as well, and then T1 and T6. So over here, its operation is slightly different from the diode bridge. In the diode bridge, the commutation is done automatically, but over here, the path of the flow of the current that depends upon the pair of the thyristor you are going to turn on, right? So if you turn on T1 and T6, then the path is from A to B, and the voltage of that phase, that line voltage between phase A and phase B, that will be appearing. And if you turn on the thyristor 1 and 2, then the conduction will be from A to C, and so on. So it depends upon your firing angle, that firing pulses, that which pair of the thyristor is turned on, and accordingly there will be the path of the flow of the current, right? So if we fire in the symmetric way, that we apply the gate pulses right at the reference points, means firing angle is 0, then you will get this output voltage waveform from your 3-phase fully controlled rectifier. Now let's look at its operation for some other firing angle. Let's suppose that for the firing angle of 30 degrees, so you will be applying the gate pulses by the delay of 30 degrees from this reference point. So alpha is 30 degree over here, so you have applied the gate pulse to the thyristor 1, assuming that the T6 is already on from the previous cycle. So if T6 is, let's suppose, is turned on, so you are going to apply the pulses to these two. And the reference point for the second thyristor is this one. These are the reference points. I'm going to mark those ones, and then I will look at the position of the gate pulses. So you can see the gate pulses of the first thyristor and the sixth thyristor are delayed by 30 degree from the reference point. Then this is the reference point from here. The gate pulses are delayed by 30 degree for the next pair of the thyristor, that is T2. Along with that, definitely T1 is to be turned on, because we need the conduction from A to C. So in the phase A, we have the thyristor 1, and for the phase C, we have the thyristor 2. So thyristor 1 and thyristor 2 needs to be turned on. So 1 is already on, that you can see over here, right? So you have already turned on. So assuming that it is in the on state, you just need to apply the pulses to the thyristor 2 and it will be turned on. And once it is turned on, so from this point onward, you can see the voltage VAC is appearing across your load because you have turned on the thyristors of that particular path. And then you are going to apply the gate pulse to the thyristor 3, right at the firing angle of 30 degree from its reference point. This is the reference point for the third thyristor. Okay, so you can see the delay. Now from this point onward, the phase voltage, line voltage BC will appear across your load till this point, and then you are going to apply the gate pulse T4, and then this voltage VBA will be appearing. Then you will apply the gate pulse to thyristor 5 and then to thyristor 6, and then this is the position of that one because the next cycle is started, and that can be shown over here. So this is going to appear across your load. So this is the voltage waveform across your load for the firing angle of 30 degree, and here you can see the area under the curve has changed. Now this area, if I mark it with a different color, let's suppose with the green, so this area is now lost. This is not appearing across your load, right? So because of that, the net area under the curve, that is going to reduce. So average DC voltage that will appear across the load, that will change. So I can sketch the average DC voltage like that. This is the DC voltage, average DC voltage that will be appearing at the output of your rectifier. So in this case, you can see there is no negative voltage. You have the highly inductive load. We will assume the continuous current over here, and the voltage is positive, no cancellation because of the negative cycle, because your voltage waveform is not reaching to the negative level. It's not going into the negative direction. However, if we change the firing angle, let's suppose that firing angle is changed to 60 degree, and above that one, you will see that there will be the negative portion that will be appearing across your load. So now let's look at the operation of this converter circuit for the firing angle of 60 degree. So over here, you are going to apply the gate pulse to your thyristor 1, assuming that previously thyristor 6 is turned on, right? So from the reference point, now this angle is of 60 degree, and this is the reference point for your first thyristor, right? So reference 1, and from here you can see the 60 degree. Now this is the reference 2. From this reference 2, you have delayed the pulse by 60 degree for the thyristor 2. So T2 is turned on by applying the gate pulse over here. And then the reference point for the third thyristor is this one for high side switch. So from here you can see the delay of the pulse will be of 60 degree. So you will be applying the gate pulse T3 right at this point. Then the reference point for your fourth thyristor, the pulse for that one is applied, and that is applied at the angle of 60 degree from the reference point. So this is the pulse for the thyristor 4, and so on, then for thyristor 5, and then for thyristor 6, right? So thyristor 6 waveform will be over here if we look at it in the cyclic way. So these are the gate pulses which are applied, and assuming that at this instant of time when you are applying that, if it is not the steady state, whether you are starting your converter, then you will have to apply two pulses over here, T1 and T6, in order to start the operation of your converter. So these pulses which you are going to apply are generated by your microcontroller or microprocessor, and later on we will discuss the optocouplers and isolation circuits and other requirements, gate driver circuits for these thyristors. So these pulses are applied through those circuits, and they are going to turn on your switches, and you are going to get output voltage waveform. So when you are going to turn on thyristor 1 and 6, so 1 and 6 is between phase A and phase B. So you can see the VAB, this one is going to appear across the load in this interval of time. And similarly, when you are going to turn on the T2, T1 is previously on. So when T1 is on, so let me look at that one. What will be the path? Phase A, T1 is on, and along with that, phase C is being turned on. So that is T2. So T1 and T2, they are being they are in the on state over here, and VAC will be appearing across the load because the thyristor is connecting these two phases. So this will be the area under the curve. and then in this section T2 and T3 will be on, so this voltage waveform will be appearing across the load. And then in the next section over here, T3 and T4 will be on from this point till this point, and this will be the area, and so on. So your area at the output is changed. So because of that, the average DC voltage will change. So let's assume then that this is the average voltage that you are going to get at the output, and you can see that with respect to the previous case when it was 30 degree, it has now reduced. So by increasing the firing angle, the output voltage is going to reduce because the area under the curve will be reduced. And still up to this point, if you look at that, you have just touched the negative voltage, but you have not gone into the negative range. You have just touched the zero voltage. So up to firing angle of 60 degree, from 0 to 60 degree, there is only positive voltage at the output. But now if you increase the firing angle above 60 degree, negative voltage will appear across the load for the highly inductive load, not for the resistive load. In the case of resistive load, the current will become zero right at the zero crossing of your voltages, and your thyristor will be turned off. But in the case of inductive load, as the current lags behind the voltage, so your current will not become zero, and the zero crossing of the voltage has arrived. So your thyristor will keep on conducting and the negative voltage will appear across the load. So we have already discussed in the previous videos that you can get rid of that negative voltage by connecting a freewheeling diode in parallel to your load if you want to wipe that one. But if you are not going to use that freewheeling diode, the negative voltage will be appearing across your load. So now let's look at for the firing angle of 90 degree, right? So for firing angle of 90 degree, you are going to delay the pulses of thyristor one, all of these thyristor, by 90 degree from the reference point. So reference point for thyristor 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So from this reference point, now this is the angle of 90 degrees. So you are going to apply the pulse to your thyristor 1 right at this point, and along with that, we are assuming that the thyristor 6 is previously on, right? So 1 and 6 are on, so they are connecting phase A and B. So this is the, if you look at this part, is this waveform VAB. So it is going to appear across your load from this point till this point, until you are going to fire the next thyristor for the highly inductive load. This portion will be there, right? Why it is not going to stop at zero? Because the current is continuous. For highly inductive load, current is continuous. Your current has not reached to zero, so that's why your switch T1 and 6 will remain in the on state, and this area will be appearing across your load, and similarly this negative part will also be appearing until and unless you fire the next thyristor. So as our firing is symmetric, we are firing all the thyristor at the same angle from the reference point. So starting from here, now if you look at the angle of 90 degree, so alpha is 90 degree, and you are going to apply the pulse to the second thyristor T2 at this point. So from here onward, as you have turned T2 on, T1 was previously on, so T6 will be turned off, right? So when the T6 will be turned off, and the T1 and T2 are conducting from here, T1 and T2, so the voltage, because of that, this is phase A, and because of T2 it is phase C, so VAC will start appearing across the load. So here you can see a portion of the voltage waveform, area under the curve of this VAC will be appearing across the load. So you have the positive part as well as you have the negative part. Same was over here, positive and the negative. And if you keep on firing these pulses, applying these pulses, now over here you are going to apply the pulse to thyristor T3. So when the T3 will be turned on, in this interval T2 and T3 are on, so VBC is maximum, is the voltage because of the T2 and T3. So if I highlight that one, so this will be this portion, right? So this is basically appearing across the load, this portion, this area, right? And then you are going to fire the next thyristor by applying the gate pulse to the T4. So when you are going to fire, so this voltage waveform will be appearing because over here T3 and T4 will be on. So when T3 and T4 are on, you will be linking phase B with the phase A. Current will be starting from phase B and will be ending at phase A. So let's trace that one, T3 and T4. So T3 is this one, right? So you can see the current is starting from phase B through the T3 and then through the load back to your phase A, right? Because thyristor 4 is on. So this is the path of the current through your load, right? And that's why the voltage between phase B and phase A, that is appearing across the load. So this is the voltage waveform. Then you will be applying the gate pulse to the thyristor 5, and when you will be applying the pulse to the thyristor 5, T4 is previously on. So when T4 and T5 are on, so what will be the path of the current T4 and T5? So T5 is on, it means the current is going to flow from phase C through this thyristor and then through the load and from T4 back to your source. So T4 is this one, so back path is constant over here, phase A starting from phase C, so C to B. So and so on, you can trace that path. So when you are going to apply the gate pulse to T5 and T4 are on, and T5 and T4 are on, so the path will be from phase C to phase A. So phase C to A voltage will appear across your load, and that is this one that you can see, VCA. So this will be appearing, and that is marked over here. This one, this is basically VCA, right? A portion of that one. So this area will be covered across the load, right? And then at the angle of 90 degree from the reference point of the T6, you are going to apply the pulse, and that will be over here. So that pulse is basically over here. This is T6, and from here onward this voltage waveform will be appearing. So one thing that you can note, that all of these pulses are at the angle of 60 degree with respect to each other. So if you decide about the angle of this thyristor 1, right, same the next angle, thyristor 2 angle can be obtained by just adding the 16 that one, then thyristor 3 angle will be obtained by angle 120 degree, then the angle for thyristor 4 will be obtained by this one, for thyristor 5 it will be obtained as 240, and then over here, right? So whatever angle, the starting angle is there, if you decide about that one over this, and then the next pulse will be at the angle of 60 degree from that one. So all of these pulses will always be at the angle of 60 degree for the symmetric firing. Symmetric firing means that you have the same firing angle for all of these thyristors. So if you have unsymmetric firing, then you will have to decide about the pulse, and that is not the topic of discussion at the moment. In this course we will be discussing about the symmetric firing. So if you have the symmetric firing, every phase will be contributing equally, all the thyristors will be conducting for equal interval of time, all of them will be contributing for the all the phases will be contributing equally, right? So over here you can say, if you talk about the average voltage, average voltage will be zero because you have the same positive and the negative area, and they are cancelling each other. So for the firing angle of 90 degree, your output voltage is zero. So how you can make it positive? Just take a freewheeling diode, connect it over here. So if you connect a freewheeling diode, so this negative part will be chopped, and you will only be having the positive part. So with the freewheeling diode, this will be the area under the curve. No voltage over here because the negative voltage will be chopped by your freewheeling diode, we can say. So only the positive area will be appearing if you connect a freewheeling diode over here, and the conduction loop will be like this. So you will be having some DC value at the output if you have the freewheeling diode. But if you do not have the freewheeling diode, then the positive as well as the negative area, both of them will be appearing, and because of that there will be the zero output voltage from your rectifier circuit. Okay, now let's look at the firing angle of 120 degrees. So if you apply the pulses from the reference points at the angle of 120 degree, so you will see that that voltage waveforms will be completely negative. So let's look at that one part only. Starting from this reference, this is the point of 120 degrees. So we are going to apply the pulse to thyristor 1, and assuming that the TC is on from the previous switching interval, so T1 and T6 are in the on states, and T1 and T6, you know that relate phase A and phase B. So this is the path of the current for this particular combination. So from A to B, right, this is from A to B. So phase voltage A and B those should appear across your load. So if you trace that this waveform VAB, so you are going to apply the pulse right at this position. So from this point onward, this voltage will appear across your load because you have turned on T1 and T6. So this is completely negative area which is appearing across your load. And then you are going to fire your next thyristor by applying the gate pulse at 60 degree from here. And from its own reference, it will be at 120 degree. Its reference point is this one, reference of the thyristor 2. So this is 120 degree. So when you are going to apply the pulse to that one, so T1 and T2 are on, and T1 and T2 are linking this one. T1 and the T2 is this one, right? So you have the conduction from phase A toward phase C. So VAC, if you trace this one, so VAC is going to appear. So this area will be appearing across your load terminal. T1 and T2 will be conducting in this part, right? Over here T1 and T6 were conducting. And then you are going to apply the next gate pulse. Next gate pulse 60 degree from the previous pulse, or 120 degree from its reference. This is the reference of the third thyristor. So from here it is 120 degree. So what will be the path of the current? T2 is previously on, and along with that you are turning on T3. So T2 and T3 will determine the path of the current. So T2 and T3. T3 is this one. This is connected with phase B. So starting from phase B through the thyristor, T3 downward in the load, and then the T2. Where is T2? T2 is this one, right? So we have the conduction from phase B to the phase C. So B to C conduction. So B to C voltage will be appearing. So if you look at this waveform B to C, this portion of the voltage waveform will be appearing across the load. And so on, if you keep on applying the pulses at the angle of 60 degree with respect to each other, over here you are going to apply for T4 and then for T5 and then for T6, and I can show those pulses over here. This is the position for T6, this is the position for T5, right? So you can see, so that this area will be covered by the voltage waveform at the output, and it's the completely negative voltage. So output DC voltage will be negative if you have the firing angle of 120 degree and above, right? So why you are getting this negative voltage? Because you do not have freewheeling diode. That you can see over here, no freewheeling diode. If you will be having the freewheeling diode over here, then if you apply the pulses at 120 degree, nothing will be appearing at the output because the diode will not allow any negative voltage to appear across your load. It will be conducting in this loop. So without freewheeling diode, with the firing angle higher than 90 degrees, you will be getting the negative voltage at the output, and at 120 degree the output is fully negative. There is no contribution of the positive area. Right now we have seen the operation of this fully controlled three phase rectifier for different firing angles, for 30 degree, for 60 degree, for 90 degree, for 120 degree, and we have seen that we can control the output voltage by changing the firing angle. And these firing angle are applied from your microcontroller of the processor, that is the brain of your control. You will be deciding about the position of the pulses, and you will be controlling the output voltage. So what information do you require? You require the reference points. If you have these reference points through your waveforms, then you can generate, you can calculate the angle easily, and you can use the PWM channels, counters, timers of your microprocessor to implement the controller for this controlled rectifier. Okay, now let's quickly look at the currents for the highly inductive load. So for highly inductive load, the load current will be continuous, and for any firing angle, if we have the symmetric pulses, symmetric firing, that each thyristor is fired at the angle of 30 degree from the previous one, so you can look at the current waveforms over here. First of all, this cycle is starting from here. Let's assume this one. So then T1 and T2 are turned on. So you can see the current in the thyristor 1. Let me take a different color to represent it. T1, and then the current in the thyristor 2. So you can observe in this interval, these two thyristors are conducting. In the next interval, T2 and T3 are on, so you can see the current through the thyristor 2 and thyristor 3. And then in the next interval, T3 and T4 conduct, so T3 and T4 current over here, and then T4 and T5, and then T5 and T6, and then T1 and T6, T1 is conducting, and T6, so that you can see over here as well, same one, T1 and T6. So this happens repeatedly. Each thyristor conducts for 120 degree interval. This is the total conduction time for one particular thyristor. So thyristor 1 is going to turn on at this point, and it is on up to this point. This is the interval of 120 degree. Similarly, this interval is of 120 degree, and the next interval for the thyristor 3 is of 120 degree, and so on. So every thyristor is conducting for 120 degree, right? And the pulses are generated at the angle of 60 degree from the very first firing angle. So you decide the firing angle. Okay, if I go back and to look at over here, you decide the firing angle. First pulse angle is calculated from here, let's suppose 60 degrees, then you will be applying the pulse over here. For 90 degree, you will be applying the pulse over here, and for 120 degree, you will be applying the pulse over here, and so on. So your pulse is delayed, and you know that you can relate the angle with the time based upon frequency. Theta is equal to omega t. So if you are operating, let's suppose at 50 hertz, that is the frequency in our country, so you can find out using the angle, you can find out at what time instant you will have to apply the gate pulse, right? So you can apply the, you can calculate all of these times. So if you calculate time for first pulse, and then you know the angle of the next pulse, that is of 60 degree from that particular pulse, so you can find out the time interval, you can implement the timers, you can, with the help of the timers in your microcontrollers and processor, you can generate the pulses at the particular time stamp, right? So just you need to worry about the calculation of the first pulse, and then the next pulse will be generated by the 60 degree delay in the case of the symmetric firing angle, right? So if I summarize, we have discussed the operation of this three-phase bridge rectifier in detail, fully controlled rectifier, and we have observed its output for different firing angles. And in the upcoming videos, we will discuss the calculation, analytical procedures, and the expressions for the calculation of the output voltage. So in this, we have just observed the operation of the three-phase rectifier in detail. Now, rule of thumb is that first of all, look at that which pair of the thyristor will be on, and then if that pair of the thyristor is on, then you can see that which voltage will be appearing across your load, and then you can track or that waveform in the three-phase voltage waveforms, and you can identify which portion will be available. It's very important to identify this one, because with the help of that, you will be setting the limits of the integration in the upcoming videos to decide about the voltage level that you will be getting at the output. So you should have the deep understanding of the for the path of the current that will be there at one particular instant, and then you can see that which voltage is going to appear across the load. Okay, so when you are going to apply the pulse to the next thyristor, one of the previous thyristor will be turned off, and that will be off the either from the high side or from the low side. So you can trace that circuit at how that thyristor will be turned off. So that's all from this video. Thank you very much.